Hello friends, my name is Amruta Nadgonde and we are going to discuss about Git and GitHub. So suppose you are an automation tester and you are responsible for writing some test cases. So you develop test cases for say module 1, you test your test cases that the code is working correctly and you leave for the day. Now you are sitting in India and you are working as per the Indian time zone. Now you have another team member, tester Y, who sits in the US office and works as per the EST time zone. So tester Y is responsible for writing test cases for module 2. So after a week's time or whenever you are ready with your test cases, you share your test cases, or tester Y shares his test cases with you for the final merge of the code. So you want to test end-to-end project. So your counterpart who is in the US, he sends his test cases to you. You merge the test cases, you merge the final code and you send it back to him. So now both of you have the same copy of code. Now this approach works fine if you are going to merge this code say at the end of the project, or there are only few people working on the project. But suppose you want to check the code every day, then you both have to repeat this repeat these steps every day. So what are the limitations? First thing, it is a manual process which requires time. Means either one of you have to send your code to the other person. The other person will merge it and then send it back to you, so that you both have the same copy of the code. So next day you can start from there. So why you have to merge daily? Because both of you do not want to miss out. Suppose you are in previous case I said you are working on different models, but what if you are working on the same module? Right? If you are working on the same module, then you have to work on the same copy of the code. So every day you have to merge. So your morning time, you will complete the work, send the code to him. He will come in the office, he will take your code, then start working on your code. And at the night, he will again send it back to you. So next day morning when you come back, you start with the merged code. Now, here, what is the important thing is changes needs to be communicated properly. So suppose he makes some changes in the test cases, or he adds some code after your code, then you should make sure that you are working on the correct copy of the code. There shouldn't be any thing you should miss on, right? So this is one thing. So first is, it is a manual process and it is time consuming. Second thing is, you have to be very careful that both of you are working on the same copy of the code. And another thing is, suppose a tester who is in the US makes some changes to the code and he sends it to you. Next day morning you come to the office and you just see that the code is failing. There is some issue with the code and you are not able to understand why it is failing, or you are not able to what made the code fail. Now in that case, since you have merged the code, or you have overwritten the code, there is no way you can go back and get your previous code. Same happens with the developers. When a couple of developers working on the different parts of the application, when they merge the code and something goes wrong, there is no way they can go back if they use this manual process. So what is the solution that we have? The solution is this version control system. Now, why we require version control system? Because like I said, different people are working simultaneously on the project and they are working on different parts of the software. Now, they need to distribute their code amongst the team so that others can access their code. Now, what this version control systems allow us to do is, they allow us to share a central repository or a place where everybody can push their code and others can take it from the same place. So a version control system is basically a system that allows us to manage multiple revisions of same unit of information. So when I say multiple revisions, what I mean is, every day you are making changes to your code and every day you are pushing that code to this central repository and others are taking it from there. Similarly, others are making changes in the code and they are pushing their code to the central repository. So you and other members of the team can access that code. Now here what happens is, simultaneously different people can work on different or same modules. Whenever one is ready with their code, they can check in or they can push their code to the central repository and others have access to the correct version of the code. So we are basically keeping multiple versions of the code, and a version is created when somebody is ready to push the code or somebody checks in the code to the central repository, and then others can pull it from there. Right? Now here another advantage, other than sharing the code in a better way, the another advantage we get is, suppose something is going wrong in the current build. So the current build is failing. So what happens is, what we can do is, we can just go back to the previous version which is available, right? So we can just revert back to the previous version and we know the we have the working copy of the code. So these are the advantages this version control systems give us. There are two popular version control systems available. One is like the one which we are discussing, Git and GitHub. So GitHub is the web access where you can actually keep your repositories, and Git is the tool which you download on your machine so that you can communicate with GitHub. So GitHub is the place where all your code, so it is a server basically, so where you put your code, and Git is a software which you install locally on your machine so that you can communicate using the Git commands, right? There are other ways of communicating with GitHub. You can directly communicate through these IDEs like Eclipse or IntelliJ, but better way is to use Git, so it is independent of any tool, so you can understand how to use the commands. And like other advantage I said is, other than distributing your code, you can just retrieve the working code if there is a build failure, right? So we are just going to see a very basic operation using Git, that is committing or checking in the code and pulling the code, right? So GitHub is the website where you can manage your repositories. So I'm going to sign in. You just have to create a login for yourself. It's very easy, like any other login that you create on Gmail or anywhere else. I'm just going to sign in. Now there are some commands which you can give through a software called Git. So like I said, Git is the software which you have to download locally. So just search Git download and choose your operating system and it will just guide you. Okay, it is already installed on my machine, so I will just cancel this process, right? And now you need to know the Git commands, right? So just Google for basic Git commands, right? And this is a very nice page here. So confluence.atlassian.com, and it has all the basic commands which you need to start off with, right? So as said here, I'm going to demonstrate you how to check in and how to check out the code, or push and pull. Okay, for that, just assume that I have code available on a folder. I'll name it as Git Tester 1. Okay, now Git Tester 1 has some code and he is ready to commit that code, or he is ready to push that code. So let me just copy my old folder, right? So now Tester 1 is ready with the code, right? And he wants to distribute, or he wants to share it with other team members, right? So let me show you how to do it. So first I will have to go to that directory. So I will say cd Git Tester 1, right? Okay, now first time when you are using it, you just have to tell Git who you are, right? So for that, there is a command called git config, okay? And you have to use this parameter global, and you have to tell user name first. So which user is pushing the code? So this is my username. So I will give this first. See, all these commands are available on this web page, right? So you can see it here. Very simple. Then you have to say git config email, right? So user.email, and you have to give a valid email ID. I'm using the same email ID and username which I have used to login, right? After this, the first command I have to use is git init. So what does this git init does? It creates an empty repository at the location which you are referring to. So at the folder git tester one, it will initialize an empty repository. Once you are done with this, then there is a concept called staging in Git. So I will give a command called git add. Now what does staging mean? So suppose there are three modules you are working on correctly, and for each module you have created different Java files. So you are writing Selenium code. So you have 1.java, 2.java and 3.java. Now you have finished writing 1.java and 2.java, and now you want to commit it or you want to check in it. So you can just use this staging concept in Git, wherein you can decide how much to commit. Okay, from the entire code, how much you want to commit right now and what you do not want to commit. So you do not want to commit 3.java, so you will just say git.add 1.java, git.add 2.java. Okay, you will not you do not want to add or commit 3.java, so you will use this concept of staging. It is very this is necessary before you write the commit, right? So I am going to commit entire code, so I will say git add star, right? Okay, so every entire code is ready for commit now, and I can see the status using git dot status key, what all will be added. So what all will be committed, all these files will be committed, and now you are ready to commit. So you will say git commit. So this is a way commit is given, and you give some message. So I will say first commit by tester one, okay, and I will say enter. Okay, now you have committed the code, but is it available at the repository? Oh, sorry, I have not yet created a repository. Let me create a repository. So I will say test repo, okay, and I will say create repository. You first have to create the repository. Sorry, I forgot to do that, but yeah. So is it committed to the GitHub? No, because we haven't told where to commit the code, right? Now I am telling that I want to commit the code at test repo, so I have to copy this link, okay, I have to copy this link, and finally I will say git remote add origin, and I will give the link. And don't worry, all these commands are available here, right? So git init, git commit, right? Similarly git remote. So if you haven't connected to your local repository to remote server, add the server to be able to push it. So first time when you are doing it, you have to use this command. This command is used to connect to a remote repository. So all these commands are available here. You just have to note down the steps, right? And sorry, I have to give it in double quotes. Okay, and the final command to push, I have to say git push origin master, right? Master means I am pushing the code in master branch. It will take a while and the entire code will now be pushed to the remote repository, right? And now if you go back to GitHub and see what all is there, so the entire code is available and it says first commit by tester 1. So if we just have to note down what all we did, first we use the git init command, right? Then we use this staging concept to decide what all to commit, right? Status is just to cross verify what will be committed, and then we used a command called git commit, right, with a message. And after that we connected to the remote repository by using git remote add origin, and in order to push the code we used a command git push origin master. Now suppose this is tester 1, I have my another tester, tester Y, and he wants to now see the code pushed by tester 1. So I will say git tester 2, okay. Now this git tester 2 wants to see the code by tester 1. So let me go to that directory. So git tester 2, okay. Git tester 2 wants to see the code from git tester 1. So like we start, I will say git init. Now I don't have to log in again because I am using the same username. But ideally, this tester also has to log in using git config, right? And very simple, you just have to say git clone. Clone is for the first time when you are taking the code. For any further pull request, you have to use pull command. But for the first time, you have to use the git clone command. Everything is available here, so you can just see. Okay, and clone what? What do you want to clone? You want to clone this directory. So just click on this code and the link is here, right? This is the same link where we have pushed and same link from where we are pulling the code. So in double quotes, you have to give this. So paste it. So cloning into test repository. So now if you go back and see here in tester 2, this entire code will be pulled. You can even use Eclipse to open this. So I am in this tester 2. I will open. Okay, then here you have to just say import. Import the project. And just select the project. So git tester 2 test repo. Okay. Finish. So this code is now available. Now this is on your local machine. If you want to connect to the remote repository from here, all you have to do is just right click and team and say share project and check this checkbox. Okay, so this will do what? It will allow you to directly connect to the Git repository which is available on GitHub. So just click on refresh and you will see that you are in the master branch. And now, like I said, you can commit from here also. So if you go to team, you will be able to see some git commands here also. But it's better to use the command prompt to manage the git commands, right? So this is how you share your code using this version control system. And it is a very important concept in DevOps. Thank you.